Hello, statisticians. Mr. Young Saber here from Skew the Script. Today's topic is exploring where do we draw the line between what we consider mental health and physical health in our society. We're going to be exploring that line through the use of more complex experimental designs. Let's skew it. Today's lesson is on grouping and experiments. This is lesson 4.4 in our course sequence. And the main topic we'll be discussing today is where do we draw the line between what we consider to be a mental illness, what we consider to be a physical illness? Very interesting problem in psychology. We'll look at the data behind it. If you'd like to follow along using a handout, you can print out the guided notes at this link. Before we get into the mental health topic, we're gonna discuss blocking in the context of gender gaps in STEM. This is a concept topic we looked at last lesson, and we're gonna discuss the study we looked at last time here again. So there are large gender gaps in STEM. And one possible cause of this that we investigated last time was hiring discrimination. Potentially, there are discriminatory practices in research and industry hiring in STEM, and this means that fewer women can enter or succeed in STEM fields. So researchers at Yale designed a really incredible study to test for hiring discrimination in STEM. We're going to discuss a modified version of this. If you want the exact version, you can go to the link here. So the researchers made application materials, and they created a lot of copies of application materials for a lab manager position at a university. The only thing in all these identical copies of the application materials they changed was the name. In half the copies, the name on the application materials was John. The other half, the name was Jennifer. And they found 127 science faculty universities, and they sent them randomly either a John or a Jennifer set of application materials. They randomly assign one or the other. And the university professors and faculty then evaluated those application materials. And they thought they were for a real lab manager position at the university. They rated the applicants based on their hireability, and they gave them a starting salary estimate. And the researchers compared those two metrics across the John and Jennifer groups. This is an example of a completely randomized design. Experiment in which the experimental units are assigned to treatments completely at random. This is the SRS, a simple random sample of experiments. But there's a certain variation here that might exist that we might want to account for. For example, what if faculty members were from both tier one and tier two universities? Tier one being the most prestigious universities where the labs might be the best in the country, tier two being the second best in terms of prestige, in terms of lab quality. So if we do random assignment, on average, we should see pretty balanced groups in our assignment. We should see about half getting, half of tier one getting John, half getting Jennifer, et cetera. So we should get balanced groups here. Let's say that that happened, random assignment worked, and we controlled for confounding by getting balanced groups here. Now, let's look at the results of the study. So this is just four data points that we might be representative of results we see in the study. For the John application materials, we see different ratings of fake John from the scale of 1 to 7 in terms of hireability. Same thing for Jennifer. Now, if we compare these distributions, we see a lot of overlap. It looks like there's a lot of similarity in the ratings of both John and Jennifer resumes. So there's some difference, but there's a lot of overlap as well. Maybe these differences are not large enough to say that they're not by chance alone. Maybe we cannot prove discrimination here in the hireability ratings. Maybe those small differences we do see are by chance alone. However, what if we categorize these ratings by the tier of the university they're coming from? So for example, if we look at the tier one and tier two ratings and we compare within those groups, we see that when broken down by tier, there is little to no overlap. Schools within each tier all rated John more hireable. So the fact that we put all the tiers together and did a broad comparison made for more variability. And when we control for the variability by tier, we see those differences come into more stark terms. So how do we, in general, reduce variability due to school tier in the design of our study? We can use a randomized complete block design. That's where experimental units are first blocked or grouped by something similar, some similar trait they have. And then the units from each block are randomly assigned to treatment and compared within those blocks. This is the stratified sample. It's analogous of experiments, and it reduces variation between treatment groups at the start of the experiment. So this makes it easier to show that differences in response are really due to treatment rather than chance variation in the random assignment alone. So say, simplified version, we got 12 faculty, 6 from tier 1 universities, 6 from tier 2 universities. Let's see how we can block the experiment with this. So if you're asked to send FRQ, there's a certain set of steps you should do. First, let's block the science lab faculty members by university tier. In each block, assign a faculty member and number 1 through 6. So there's 6 in each tier here. So I've done that. I've grouped them by the similarity. I've numbered them. For the tier 1 block, write all the numbers on identical slips of paper, put them into a hat, and mix well. Draw 3 slips of paper without replacements. We're randomly selecting. The corresponding faculty are assigned Jennifer application materials. The remaining are assigned John application materials. So within tier 1, I'm gonna randomly assign to treatment John or Jennifer application materials. I'm gonna do the same thing for the tier 2 block. And then before I compare across the groups, I'm gonna first compare within the groups. I'm gonna compare hireability ranks between the John and Jen treatments within each block. So I'm controlling for that variability here a little bit, factoring that in. And then at the very end, after getting those within group differences, I'm gonna combine the results, accounting for those average differences to get the full results here. So we've reduced variability in our study, and it's gonna be a little bit easier to see if there's differences due to treatment here. Now let's talk about a specific type of block experiment called match pairs. In the context for this, we're gonna be looking at studying depression. Depression is a mental disorder that arises from a complex interaction of biological, psychological, and social factors. And knowing which factor is most influential could help treatment. So can we design an experiment that isolates which factor is the most prominent cause of depression for different individuals? However, this is really difficult to do. Individuals have very different versions of symptoms, of levels of depression, of array of chemical, biochemical, psychological, environmental conditions in their lives, and side effects from treatment. So how can we account for that huge variability by individual? Who could be the control group here? Well, what if we made the individuals their own control group? Let's see how we could do that. We could do that through a match pairs design. That's a type of randomized block experiment in which each block is composed of 2 similar experimental units, a pair. And oftentimes, a match pair is simply the same experimental unit receiving both treatments. They are paired with themselves, and the order of the treatment is randomized. So we're gonna look at a 2015 study that employed a match pairs design. It was published in JAMA, the Journal of the American Medical Association. And some people wonder, depression, is it all in your head? And research has found that it's not. And we're gonna look at a study that proves that to a certain extent. So researchers wanted to test if taking a fake pill would actually alleviate depression symptoms, even if the pill had no active ingredient. So being told, hey, this will treat your depression, would that actually alleviate depression symptoms, even if there was no real active substance in the pill? 35 people enrolled in the study, all had major depression, and none were taking any medications. So for each subject, we're trying to design a match pair experiment. So if you're asked to do this on FRQ, this is what you'd say. For each subject, flip a coin. Heads indicates they get the fake pill for the first week and no pill for the second week. Tails indicates they get the opposite order. So some of them will be taking the pill first and then no pill the second week, other ones will get the opposite order. Then after each week, have each subject fill out a depression questionnaire and undergo a PET brain scan, compare measurements for each subject and compile the results. So we're comparing within each group, which is each subject with itself, with themselves, excuse me, and we're gonna compile those results together. Now note, when you're working with real humans and living beings as your subjects, you need to make your experiments ethical. And the way they did this here was they gave the fake treatment, yes, but then they followed it up with real depression treatments from the doctors that were doing the experiment. Now, the results. On average, participants reported less severe depressive symptoms after their week with the fake pill. So even though they're taking a fake pill, they said, they reported they were less depressed. So maybe depression is all in that. Maybe it's something that you would react like. Maybe depression is something that's all in their head. It's completely psychological. However, this is the interesting part. On average, participants showed increased U-opioid, I think that's how you pronounce it, receptor brain activity in the regions of the brain associated with emotion and stress regulation. So belief in the pill and its active ingredients, even though it wasn't true, cause an actual biochemical change in their brain. So this is something called a placebo effect. And it occurs not just for what we consider to be mental disorders, but also for physical ones as well. Fake pills or placebo pills have shown to have significant benefits and actual biological ones for migraines, blood pressure, asthma, arthritis, and so many other physical illness. We see that mentally accepting that a pill will help you or a treatment will help you, even if there's nothing active in it, oftentimes will create a physical, biological change. So for both physical and mental illness, it's often hard to distinguish what is mental and what is a physical phenomenon. Mind, body, brain are connected. And it's a really interesting facet of our experience as human beings to explore the different components of that psychologically. So we have to control for what's called the placebo effect when we're experimenting with humans. Placebo is an inactive treatment. It's a sugar pill or a saltwater IV drip are common examples. And placebo effect is when subjects' belief of receiving an active treatment leads to a measured response, even though the treatment is actually inactive. The way we control for this placebo effect is by blinding. In a single blind study, either the subject or the researchers are unaware of who receives active treatment or placebo. In a double blind study, both the subjects and the researchers are unaware of who receives what. Why would you blind subjects? Well, it prevents the placebo effect because they don't know if they're getting the real thing or a fake thing, and they won't have that psychological phenomenon that actually influences their reaction. Why would you blind the researchers? It prevents confounding. So say, for example, the researchers are the ones evaluating the patient's progress in terms of whatever condition. If they know who is getting what treatment, they might be biased in how they make those evaluations because they want their studies to be successful. So it prevents that confounding factor. Finally, we talk about generalizing study results, and it's going to lead to our discussion question for today. So in the Jen John study, we looked at these results last time. Jennifer resumes and application materials on average received lower starting salary estimates and lower higher billing ratings, and these were statistically significant. Generalization is the process of using study results to make inferences about a larger population. In the Jen John study, all faculty participants were from one of only three types of science departments: biology, chemistry, or physics. So my discussion question for you is, can we generalize this result of gender hiring discrimination from the study to all scientific disciplines and subjects? Why or why not? Explain your reason. That's it for today's statisticians. Have a good one.